Well, then, as lecture, the spark should morph on the 25th August, 1970, after Isha Namaz.
ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا وحبيبنا وشفيعنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله الذي أرسل إلى الناس كافة وإلى الخلق عامة بشيرا ونذيرا بين يدي الساعة قال الله تبارك وتعالى في شأن عبيده إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم وصل اللهم على جميع الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى جميع ملائكة المعصومين وعلى جميع عباد الصالحين أما بعد لقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كلامه القديم العظيم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن في خلق السماوات والأرض واختلاف الليل والنهار لآيات لأولي الألباب الذين يذكرون الله قياما وقعودا وعلى جنوبهم ويتفكرون في خلق السماوات والأرض ربنا ما خلقت هذا باطلا سبحانك فقنا عذاب النار صدق الله مولانا العظيم وبلغ رسوله النبي الحبيب الكريم ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I am sure you remember, and I hope that most of you were there when I spoke last night at the West Street Mosque. And I took up the very important problem of what is Islam? In order to be able to make you understand as to what are those shortcomings and defaults from which we as a community are suffering today in spite of our love for Islam. In that connection, the Sri Lanka Marana, Nyata Sri Lanka. In that connection, I made certain observations last night, and I intend to continue that theme tonight, and will continue to speak on this theme until it is exhausted. My very dear brother, who spoke introducing me this evening and who is here, he made an observation and he wanted me to clarify this issue also as to why there is no stability in the devotion of Muslims to the Islamic way of life, probably if I have understood it right, because he was complaining that so many brothers are here tonight, but tomorrow morning at the Fajr prayer, he said that too few would be here, not so many. Of course, they cannot be so many because they have come from so many areas. He can expect only those people who live in this locality. But it is really a basic problem. But this problem also is a part and parcel of that basic problem which I was dealing last night in the West Street Mosque and on which I wish to continue the discussion tonight. If you meet any good Muslim today, whether he is an educated person or an uneducated person, whether you meet him in South Africa or you meet him in Pakistan or you meet him in Saudi Arabia or you meet him anywhere else, and inquire from him as to what he understands by an Islamic life, you will come to the conclusion that in most cases, probably in all cases, the reply would be that Islam is the name of five things: Kalima-e Shahada, Salat, Sawm, Zakat, and Hajj. That is correct in a way, but very, very incorrect, very, very incorrect from the basic point of view. The fact is, I should say that this attitude or this point of view has made Islam for us a sort of cult, at which I have been remarked at certain meetings. Some of you might have been angry with me as to why I am saying this, but it is so. These five things, if they are taken as a complete system of life, they form a cult. For a person who pursues them only ritualistically, and naturally, for the common man, and even for some of those big people who claim to be leaders of Islam, I have yet to meet persons who know how to pray and who know how to fast. I have yet to meet persons who know how to perform the Hajj. But the fact is that these five things are the foundations of Islam. The Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam has said, Bunyal Islamu ala khamsin. The Islamic way of life has been founded on these five things. Remember, he says that the Islamic way of life has been founded on these five things, that Islam, he uses the word Islam. Bunyal Islamu ala khamsin. Al-Islam or Islam has been founded on these five things: the Shahada, prayer, fasting during Ramadan, Zakat, and Hajj. Now, just try to think about it. It is something very simple. If you have a friend, if there is a person who lays the foundations of a house or of a building, and after laying the foundations of that building, he invites all his friends to a tea party to congratulate him on his achievement. What will his friends think about him? They'll say he has gone mad. Because although he has laid the foundations of that building, The foundations are only a means and not an end. The end of laying the foundations was to construct the building for a certain purpose, whether that building was to be a home or that building was to be a commercial area or anything else. So, anyone who leads his life without these foundations is not a Muslim. That is clear, absolutely clear, however good he may be. But he is not a Muslim, according to the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. He may be very virtuous and he may be very pious and he may be this or that. But the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam has said that these are the foundations of Islam. And the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam alone is the teacher of Islam and nobody else. Right. But if there is a person, as probably most of us are, very unfortunate, who spends the whole life only in laying the foundation, and then is called by God Almighty, now come, you have spent your time here. And he goes there without building the structure of Islam on it, without building Islam. I should say Islam, because the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam says, Buniya al-Islamu ala khamsin. So it means that there is something which is called Islam and there are the foundations for that something. So Islam has not been built. Remember this. Remember this. Only the foundations have been laid. And of course, when we lay the foundations, it all depends upon the engineer whom we employ, how solid those foundations are. The foundations themselves may be very solid and very good, and they may also be of a very meager variety, you see, or very weak. And then again, unfortunately, even these foundations are laid by most of us because of ignorance. Because of ignorance, they are very, very weak. So, we go from this world to face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to face His beloved Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, whom every one of us is going to face immediately after death. The Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, we are going to face immediately after death. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala we will face on the day of judgment. Because it is said in the hadith sahih in Sahih Sitta, that hadith is there accepted by all the ulama, that when a person dies and he is laid in the grave, the angels come to him and question him. The first question is, Mar Rabbuk? Who is thine Lord? The second question is, Mada taqulu li hadha ar-rajul? Every person who is dead is shown the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. He sees the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and the angel says, what do you say about him? So every person, whether he is a Muslim or a non-Muslim, after his death, the first personality he has to face besides the angel is the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Now, when we go from this world and we go in this fashion, if at all we go, God forbid that we go in this fashion, but if we go in this fashion, that even though we lived here for 100 years, we were just employed like a child who plays with his toys and sometimes tries to build a house and then it falls again and then builds another house of sand and then it falls again. You see, just trying to build the foundations of Islam, nothing beyond that, and thinking as if we are covering the entire field of our obligation as Muslims. What a pity. And even these foundations, very unfortunately, as I'll just now tell you from the Quran and the Sunnah, even these foundations which we lay are in most cases of an absurd variety. They are foundations only nominally. This is because we do not take the trouble of reading the Quran. Maulana is here, the ulama are here, but may I say I am one of them. I am considered to be one of the ulama. May I say that the ulama do not teach? Do not teach. I have not seen them teaching it. What they teach, even about these pillars of Islam, as they are called in English, is only the ahkam al-fiqhi. The ritualistic part of it, the legal part of it. So many sunnah, so many fard, so many wajib, so many this, so many that. All right. That is Islam, of course. But how to pray? Ghalib had said about the haji. He said, Jama'e ihrami zahid far naja. Don't be deceived by this ihram which the haji has put on himself. Jama'e ihrami zahid far naja. Tha haram me ek na mehram raha. While he was in the haram, he didn't know what the haram is and what the haji is. He just put on the dress and went through the ritual. So, to perform the namaz according to those fixed rites, there are so many sunnah and so many nawafil and so many mustahabbat in wudu and then in prayer like this and like this. Quite all right. That is the structure of prayer and wudu that has been given to us by the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. We can't avoid it. We must pray in that manner. That is our duty. But is prayer merely a gymnastic? Is it merely a gymnastic? Or anything else? Pardon me, it is not a gymnastic. It is communion with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah. Communion. It is meant, it is an action whereby the abd or the servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes into contact with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is not a gymnastic, this is not a ritual. This is not. Ritual never fails, my dear brothers. If you just perform the ritual of feeding yourself with the food that you eat, you see, without taking care as to what you are eating and how it has been cooked, whether it is healthy for you or not, and in what quantity you should eat, and at what time you should eat, without taking into consideration the utilitarian factors, the factors with regard to the utility of the food, and you just go on with the ritual of taking the food, within 3 days' time you will enter the hospital. Sure. You are not going to remain healthy. So ritual doesn't pay. Ritual has no meaning. Ritual is like a dead body. Unless the spirit is there, it has no meaning. Just as a dead human being has absolutely no value. It is only so long as the spirit is there inside the human being that he is a human being. When that spirit goes, even the dearest, even those who hold him dear to his heart will say, make haste, remove him from here and bury him under the earth. He is not worthy of being here on the face of the earth. And what will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say about the dead, spiritless ritual? The Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam says about a prayer which is said with absent-mindedness, that it is thrown into the face of the worshipper. Get out from here. Take it with you. We don't need it. How do we pray, my dear brothers and sisters? Just a habit for most of us. Just a fear that if we don't pray, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will become angry or anything of that sort and some calamity might fall because, pardon me again here. Why do we pray, sir? Inquire from yourselves. And, I'm sorry. Inquire from others. you will find that in the subconscious there is an idea. I want the goods of this world. I want the good things of this world. And I want to avoid the evil things right here. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone can protect me against evil. He alone has the power. And He alone can bestow benefits on me. So I should go and pray. How many of us, when they mange dua, when they make the dua after namaz, how many of us, with their true heart, with genuinely pray for anything else except the things of this world? How many of us say to God, as the Sufis preach and teach, and as they have taught, Allahumma anta maqsoodi wa muradi wa ilayka istinadi wa ridaaka matloobi? Oh, no. Not his pleasure. That is not my goal of to acquire his pleasure. When Imam Hussain had to die with his family, they are killed. He was martyred. You see, at Karbala. What? Oh Lord, I am not worthy of loving thee. Thou may remain where thou art, but give me the things of this world right here now. That is all. I am a worthless creature. This is the type of thinking. I have these few hair that you see, which are now white. They have not become white just like that. I have seen millions of people of different communities. And I have probed and searched into their hearts. What do they want? Innocently they want just this. Now, I'll talk about prayer only tonight, inshallah, because that will need more than 1 hour probably. What is the need for prayer? Beyond the needs that we feel about prayer, that the need is that if we have got a problem in this life, it may be solved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of course, we should pray to Him for that also. Naturally. Who is there else, you see, to whom we will pray? The Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam has taught us that even for the shoelace, you should pray to God. That's all right. But what is the function of this prayer? And how should it be prayed? How should it be performed? How did the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam perform it? Alright, you may say that he was the greatest and the highest in God's creation. What are we, tiny human beings, just nothing as compared to him. So why do you bring forth his case or his instance? We can't imitate him. Alright. Then imitate his followers. We are followers, they are followers. About the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, I may say this at least, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. And also, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ. So we have got to imitate him according to our caliber, of course. But we have got to imitate him. What is reported about him? And what did he teach in that connection? He was so exact about it that even when you come to the mosque to join the congregation, he has said, do not run. Come to the mosque, even if you are losing that rakat, you see, let it be lost. But come, bis sakinati wal waqar. This is the hadith in Bukhari. With dignity and sobriety and calmness and composure. You are going to participate in a great spiritual act. Remember this, it is not a ritual. It is not just an outward act. You will have to concentrate with your entire personality there. And how he would pray? It is said that while he would pray with the human beings, with his followers, those prayers were not long, very long. Of course, longer than we pray. But when he was alone with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he was alone, it is recorded in the books of Hadith, that he would sometimes stand still for hours. Hatta tawarramat qadamahu. These are the words of the Hadith. Until his feet would swell. You know that if you become stationary in standing, then the blood circulation is affected. The pumping action of the heart is affected, and blood starts accumulating in the lower part of the body. So he would stand so still, without the slightest movement, that it would accumulate in the feet. And sometimes the skin of the feet would burst, the capillaries would burst, and blood would ooze out. When he prayed, Ummul Mu'mineen Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha has reported that if sometimes we happened to be so near as to hear him praying, we could hear as if it was a big boiling pot which was boiling. You see, when a big vessel in which something is cooked, it boils, then it gives a certain sort of sound. Such sound would come from his chest. It was not just so many sunnah, so many farz, so many wajib, stand up like this, go like this and go like this and finish. Assalamu alaikum rahmatullah, assalamu alaikum rahmatullah. Get out. No. No. How did his followers pray? I'll give you just one instance. Maybe that you have heard it already, and that's why I am giving it. It is a very authentic instance. Once Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib, karramallahu ta'ala wajhul kareem, he was wounded with a poisoned arrow. The poisoned arrow had two fangs, so it pierced his body, and in order to take it out, the fangs pressed his whole flesh from there, you see, to come out. And so it was something painful. Now Sayyidina Ali was very powerful physically. He had steel nerves. But even he couldn't bear it. But that was a poisoned arrow. It had got to be taken out. So Sayyidina Ali said, all right, let me start my salat. Let me start my salat. And when I go into sajda, pull it out. And when he went into sajda, it was pulled out. There was not the slightest impact on him of all that pain which it must have caused. This is prayer. This is the prayer of Sayyidina Ali. And similar was the prayer of Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Sayyidina Farooq al-Azam radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Sayyidina Uthman al-Ghani, and so many of them. This was the prayer which the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam taught. And what did he teach to us for all time? He laid down a law, not only for prayer, but for all service in the way of God, because Islam has conceived the whole life for a Muslim as life of ibadah. We don't have that concept of Christians and Hindus that only ritual worship is ibadah and all else is worldly things. Anything done for the sake of God, whether even eating and even earning your livelihood, all that is ibadah. Acquiring knowledge, all that is ibadah in Islam. But naturally, prayer would be classified as the foremost ibadah. It is ibadah proper, because it is done with a devotional emphasis.
What has the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam? He says, he has commanded. Look here. It is in the form of a command. فَعْبُدْ رَبَّكَ كَهَنَّكَ تَرَاهُ. Worship thy Lord as if thou art seeing him and then worshipping him. فَإِنْ لَمْ تَكُنْ تَرَاهُ فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاكَ. And so long as this is not possible for thee, the lowest mode of worship is that thou should worship as if he is seeing thee and thou art worshipping him. What do we do, my dear brothers and sisters? All the various thoughts which have been even away from us while we were not praying, they come, they crowd in our mind. We are uttering the words of prayer, but our mind is somewhere else. And I'll give you a personal experience of mine. There was a saint, not of a high order, a Sufi, near Meerut. His name was Sayyid Abdul Ghani. I used to go to him just to sit in his company. His room was his room was at a place from where the window opened into the courtyard of the adjoining mosque. So it was, so to say, a part of the mosque itself. This Sufi would never come to pray in the mosque. Now, that's why you see so many ulama and so many people now decry these Sufis. You say, oh, they are against the Sharia, but they do not understand things. These who decry the Sufis, they do not understand things, unfortunately. I felt several times, so what is this? This man talks about God all the time and quotes from the Quran and this and that and about his spiritual development. He never goes into the masjid. Of course, he used to pray, but pray only in his room. One day he was asked to explain his conduct. Had to be asked. He said, do you want to know? Do you want to know why I don't go to the mosque? All right. Let the congregation fix itself. Let the prayer, congregational prayer begin. It was Asr time prayer. The Imam Sahab came and stood on the musalla. The Muazzin called the Iqama. The worshippers came and stood behind. Prayer is started. He said, now look here. He took off his cap and put the cap on the inquirer's head. He took off his cap. This is a personal experience, mind you. He took off his cap from his head and put it on the inquirer's head. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. It was a very ugly spectacle. The Imam was in the form of an animal. All the worshippers were in the form of different varieties of animals. Some like dogs and some like swines and some like foxes and some like this and some like that. It was not conjuration, mind you. It was just putting his cap on the head of the inquirer and said, see the reality. Do you want me to pray with them? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered in the Quran, Warkau ma'a raki'in. Are these raki'in? All right, leave it there. The Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam has said, La salata illa bi huduril qalb. No prayer is prayer except with the fullest concentration of mind. On what? On Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is this act of prayer? What is this act of prayer? Just try to think about it in a very simple manner. I am not talking philosophy tonight, but very simple thing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator, the ruler, the governor and controller of this entire universe and everything here. His majesty and his grandeur and his greatness is infinite. We cannot conceive it. He is under no obligation to us. He is under no need from anything that he has created. He is as-samad. The entire world is dependent on him, and he is independent of everything. So great. Allahu Akbar. With all his greatness, look at his love for us. The prime minister of a country, or the head of the state, or even the provincial administrator, or even the local chairman or something, and even a Muslim multimillionaire would not like you to come at his door all the time, or even not once in life. He would hate it. Why have you come to disturb me, you dirty fellow? Is that so? It is so. But he is the King of Kings. And out of his love, he has proclaimed that a man will proclaim to you 5 times a day, Hayya ala al-falah, Hayya ala al-falah, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah. He will call you to my audience. Yani, we in our worldly life want to have audience with people who are bigger than us. We think it will be an honor for us. But here he who is really great, before whom nothing is great, he is inviting himself. Inviting with love, mind you. And when we perform the prayer ritualistically, it is the greatest insult we can do to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because if you are my friend and you come to me and start talking to me with love, and I just turn my face and answer you with a very dry face and a very dry tone, will it not be an insult for your love? You will say, damn yourself, I am not going to do anything with you. Oh, you are whatever you may be. Isn't that so? All right. He invites us with love, mind you. He does not need human beings to come and stand up and say that we are trained to God. No. The angels who are much greater in number are all the time doing tasbih and tahleel around the arch and all over this universe. He does not need we tiny human beings. What are we? And even those angels he never needs, you see. Those angels do it because that is their food. They can remain alive only through zikrullah. They also do it that way, you see. Not because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala needs it at all. He is as-samad. He invites us. He says, Fazkuruni azkurkum. Talk to me, I'll talk to you. Look here. This is not merely so many sunnah, so many farz, so many this and so many that. That is all right. I don't say anything against it, you see. But he is inviting you on a definite mission. You must know what that mission is. To commune with him. Why? The question might arise in our minds. Why does he invite us? He invites us. Why? Because he has made us Khalifatullah. Because he has made us his vicegerent. And the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam has commanded us, Takhallaqu bi akhlaqillah. Imbue yourselves with divine qualities. And that is the only way. You see, when the iron filings come into contact with the magnet, they are magnetized. If they don't come into contact with the magnet, they remain iron filings. But when they are magnetized, they don't become magnets. The magnet remains the magnet. They are only magnetized. When the abd of Allah approaches him with the same spirit of love, as the Quran says, Alladheena amanu ashaddu hubban lillah. When he approaches Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with love, then he is magnetized. He is magnetized. People sometimes raise the question. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said about himself and about all Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam, there is a hadith in which he says that the earth cannot eat the body of the prophets. One gentleman once asked me, he said, how can it be? Well, the prophets are also mortal, the other human beings are also mortal. I said, my dear brother, I put to you a very simple problem from science, from physics. If you take a piece of iron and bury it in the earth, it will get rusted and will ultimately be liquidated. It will be eaten by the earth. If you magnetize that piece of iron and place it there, the earth cannot eat it even in 1,000 years. That is the way the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam shown to us. The way to immortality. Not a mere gymnastic in prayer and this and that, and we have finished and we have been praying for 40 years and so has performed the Hajj 50 times. Nonsense. He may have performed the Hajj 1,000 times. Taharam mein ek na mehram raha, if he has performed the Hajj even once properly. Very good. If 1,000 times improperly, he has wasted his time and wasted his money. That is why it is said that one sajda is enough for your salvation. If it is sajda. If it is sajda. If one sajda you can perform in real devotion as is abd, and that consciousness dawns on you and grips you, you are saved from everything. And 1,000 sajdas, فَوَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنْ صَلَاتِهِمْ سَاهُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ يُرَاءُونَ. It is only an exhibition that I am a namazi. I have seen people, you see, there in Hong Kong and in Singapore, there is a family which calls itself namazi. Just as people call themselves haji. Are Baba, why haji? But that was an obligation on you. Why do you put this word namazi? I am the haji so and so. What? Is it a title? Who gave you this title? Then you must also have the title namazi so and so, rozedar so and so, zakat payer so and so. What? Beating about the bush, running after the shadows, and not trying to understand the reality. Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala call us? Who are we? Who are we? He says about us. About us. Leaving aside God's prophets, they are too great. About us all he says, Inna aradna al-amanata ala samawati wal-ardi wal-jibal. Verily, I presented the amana or the trust, my trust, on the heavenly bodies and the earth and the mountains, whom you consider to be symbols of stability and solidity. Inna aradna al-amanata ala samawati wal-ardi wal-jibal fa abayna an yahmilnaha.
they refused to accept the trust. They said to God, "Oh Lord, we cannot. We are incapable of." They refused to accept the trust. وَحَمَلَهَا الْإِنسَانِ. And this two-legged creature, 5 feet in height, went forward and said, I want it. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّهُ كَانَ ظَلُومًا جَهُولًا. He has proved to be ungrateful and ignorant. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again saying out of affection, mind you. إِنَّهُ كَانَ ظَلُومًا جَهُولًا. As you say to your son, بَلَيْ بَيَقُوفُ. How foolish you are, my dear son. What have you done about your such and such job? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying out of affection, إِنَّهُ كَانَ ظَلُومًا جَهُولًا. And then he lays down the law that now, of course, when you have committed this, and any one of you commits this, any wrong, then لِيُعَذِّبَ اللَّهُ الْمُنَافِقِينَ وَالْمُنَافِقَاتِ وَالْمُشْرِكِينَ وَالْمُشْرِكَاتِ وَيَتُوبَ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ. They would say, we are the bearers of the amanah. We are supreme in God's creation. And that's why he wants to train us, he wants to build us. And for that he sent the prophets, not for rituals, to build us into his khalifas. And do you know what the khalifa means? Here again, unfortunately, I have heard Muslims wrangling with one another as to what it means. The word khalifa has three meanings. He who comes after. فَخَلَفَ مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ خَلْفٌ. According to the Quranic verse, khalifa, he who comes after. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, according to the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam, hadith is a being who has no before and no after. He has no after. He is infinite. So the human beings are not khalifa in that sense at all. Then the khalifa can mean the deputy, the naib. And you will find in certain translations of the Quran the word naib used absolutely wrong. What? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have a naib? This is blasphemous. He should have a naib. Why? The Queen of England can have her viceroy in Australia and in Canada. Because she is a poor lady, a human being. Her powers are finite and limited. She cannot administer that far off country directly. So she sends there a person, invests that person with the prerogatives of royalty and calls him the viceroy, deputy of the king or the queen. Does Allah need this? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about himself, وَاللَّهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ مُحِيطٌ. Allah encompasses everything. وَاللَّهُ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. He is the Almighty. He does not need an app. Then what does this word khalifa mean? What are we, sir? If we are not his naib or deputy, and if we are not those who came after him, God forbid, he is eternal. What does the word naib, this khalifa means? According to the best authorities, it means here, mutasarrif fil umur. Mutasarrif fil umur. He who can change things. He who can interfere in things. And this is the function of man. God created this good earth, but did not create a single house. Did not make a single mechanized road. Did not create a single piece of furniture. Did not make this microphone. Did not make this car. Gave it to us raw and said, you are the Khalifa. And then the progeny of Adam started working as the Khalifa. Step by step they found out the laws. Step by step he sent his prophets and they taught the laws of life, of culture and civilization and medicine and health and cure, all those things. You read it in the Quran. For instance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about Sayyidina Dawood alayhi salam, وَعَلَّمْنَاهُ صَنْعَةَ لَبُوسٍ لَكُمْ. At another place Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَعَلَنَّ الْحَدِيدِ. About Dawood alayhi salam, who was a prophet, his function was not merely to give some spiritual and moral teachings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that we taught him how to make armor. We taught him how to change the iron ore into iron and then into steel and use it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about himself that we taught this prophet. So from this we understand that the function of the prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was not only to teach spiritual things and moral things or moral principles, but also to teach the ways of culture and civilization, even of technology. And in this manner, this humanity, this Khalifatullah fil Ard, this humanity progress. When it progressed, it has been carrying out the tasarruf, converting things into different things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created the metals of which this microphone is made. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created the brain and the mind and all those faculties there in the human being. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ultimately the creator of everything. But his Khalifa does the job. He makes the microphone. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's angels grow the trees. You see, but they don't make the microphone. It has been laid as an obligation on man that he should make the microphone, he should make the rail car, he should make the aeroplane, he should make the roads, he should erect the buildings and use his reason, about which the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam has said that it is the best asset that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to human beings. All right. Now, here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of his attributes is al-musabbir, the fashioner. Here the Khalifa imitates that attribute of God, he becomes al-musabbir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created things ab novo, as they say in Latin, out of nothing. But his Khalifa also creates, not out of nothing, of course, he can't, he is the Khalifa, poor fellow. But he creates, and that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said about himself, فَتَبَارَكَ اللَّهُ أَحْسَنُ الْخَالِقِينَ. Allah is not the only Khaliq, there are many other Khaliqs and he is the best among them. Don't think that there are many other Khaliqs of this universe. Here, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pointing out about the human inventors who are his khulafa. He has used the word plural. فَتَبَارَكَ اللَّهُ أَحْسَنُ الْخَالِقِينَ. The best of creators. So the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam has laid down a law for us that your destiny is to become imbued with divine attributes. تَخَلَّقُوا بِأَخْلَاقِ اللَّهِ. And for this تَخَلُّقُ بِأَخْلَاقِ اللَّهِ, or to be imbued with divine attributes, we need to be magnetized. It is our need. I go back to the theme from where I left. We need to be magnetized. How can we be magnetized? Unless the iron filings are within the range of the magnetic waves of a magnet, they will not be magnetized. There is a particular range. That range has got to be acquired by us. He says, come near to me. Wasjud waqtarib. These are the words of the Quran. Prostrate and come near. Attain nearness to me in order to acquire that range of becoming magnetized. The more a person remains away from God, the less there is a chance for his becoming magnetized. It is not that God is finite. He is, of course, everywhere. But this range has to be acquired by the human being himself, although God is there within you. Nahnu aqrabu ilayhi min hablil barid. He says that I am nearer to you than your jugular vein. But in spite of this, the nearness has got to be acquired, that range has got to be acquired whereby we can become magnetized. This is salat. That's why the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, La salata illa bihudur al-qalb. Prayer is not prayer until and unless it is done with the total concentration of personality. And that's why he taught that when you begin the prayer, when you begin the prayer, do like this. What is it? Have you ever thought about it? I'll tell you something which you might never have heard, or it's not there in any book. These fingers of the hand, they are the writing of Allah. The alif is there, the lam and all that is there, and the hay is here. There is no other word for God in any language which can be symbolized in this fashion in the hands of man. And you know one thing more? In the hands of man there are lines. This is 18. This is 81. How much are they then? 99. The 99 names of God. So when I go for prayer, I raise these hands here, bring them here, that for the sake of Allah to my east and for the sake of Allah to my west, and with his 99 names, I withdraw myself from the world. It is not just like this. Anybody comes, oh, prayer is going on. It is not. You should pause for minutes before adopting this attitude, what I am going to do. And that's why it has been said that a person who does not full serenity and calmness, with full serenity and calmness, he is not here. At every step, you must be conscious of what you are doing. At every step. Everything must be with consciousness. All right, this, then this. What does it mean? When you fold the hands, it is the demonstration from your side that, O Allah, I am your slave, your most obedient. This is the symbol of obedience, folding the hands. You see? But if you, while you fold the hands, you are thinking of football and rugby. Or of the stock exchange and the share market and the group area there and the transfer from one area to another. Allahu Akbar. It is not fair. And then this attitude of obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has got to be developed. First you stand like this. With full humility in your posture. Then increase this posture of humility and go into ruku. This is increasing the posture of humility and affirming Subhana Rabbi al-Azim. Allah alone is great, not me, I am nothing. Unless you become the empty beggar's bowl, Baba, like this, then the blessings of Allah will not come to you. You see, because if your bowl is like this, they will come and fall there. Make it like this. in all humility, as humble as you can become. So this is what you are taught. Subhana Rabbi Razim. Then don't say it by way of rote, like a parrot. Subhana Rabbi Razim. Three times? Oh, Maulana Sahib taught three times is enough. All right, three times. Stand up. And before the Maulana Sahib goes into the Imam goes into the sajda, the Muqtadi wants to go before him. You see? Then this climax has got to be raised to the, it has got to be brought to a climax. This humility, mind you, that I am a beggar, O Lord. I have come here to beg. I am nothing. I have emptied myself of all vanity and of all thoughts about myself. Thou art alone existence and thou art alone the real being and thou art everything. I am nothing. And for that he goes into prostration and says, Subhana Rabbi al-Ala. Here he uses the word al-Ala, the high, because he has become low. Look at the contrast. That spirit has to be acquired. And wallahi, billahi, tallahi, experience it. If you can prostrate before God like this, physical world. I am standing in the masjid and I am saying this with three times the oath. It is. The Quran has said it. Wasjud waqtalib. Come near to me in prostration, in the sajda. That is the point of nearness. But is the sajda also performed as a ritual? Nothing. Nothing obtained. It is like a person, like a blind person who just roams about, he walks the whole day and never reaches his destination. Allahu Akbar. This is prayer. What happens? And I may tell you again one very important thing about prayer. In this there is a confusion among Muslims, but there should be none. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is almighty. His knowledge encompasses everything, the past and the present and the future. He knows whatever passes in the human mind, even the feelings he knows. Everything he knows. He is all power. But what is his law? He has appointed the angels. Millions and billions and trillions of them. You cannot count them. He has appointed the angels. They are the functionaries of His divine order. You might think, well, it means that Allah is not all-powerful. Yes, look here. For every act, He needs the intermediation of an angel. He has got an intermediary here. Oh, angel so-and-so, you do this job, and you so-and-so, you do this job, and I am here on my earth. Allah cannot be all-powerful. This can be a mode of thinking. It is not so. It is not against the almightiness and His quality of being all-knowing that He has appointed the angels to perform different functions. That is His mode of administration. He knows in His wisdom, we tiny human beings with a few ounces of brain here cannot know. Listen. Then look at the structure of prayer which you are taught. This is a very important point. Every gift has got to be presented either to a friend or to a superior in a very neat and clean fashion in a beautiful casket. Don't you? Now this
Praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the sort of gift which you are presenting as a humble slave. Huh? It should not go just like that in thin air. It should go in a casket. What is the casket? When you read Surat al-Fatiha, you start like this. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Maliki Yawmiddin. This is the praise of the Lord. All praise is due to Allah, the Lord of the worlds, the most beneficent, the most merciful, master of the day of judgment. Then you present your beggar's bow. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. O Lord, we worship Thee alone, and Thine help we seek in all things. All right. Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. Now here you are demanding the greatest blessing of God. A person may have wealth, a person may have knowledge, a person may have power, a person may have beauty, a person may have a whole army of his supporters. But unless he is rightly guided, he cannot benefit from any of these blessings. So the basic blessing is the hidayah. He should be rightly guided. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught us, not like Christians, O Lord, give us our daily bread. Poor people couldn't think beyond this daily bread. Pet laga hai, pet laga hai, pet laga hai. Islam is not teaching that. Islam is teaching the fundamental thing. Ihdina as-siratal mustaqim. And remember here another very important point. Just in passing, all the prayers that the Holy Quran has taught or the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam has taught, they are in the plural gender. What do they indicate? That a Muslim, if he goes selfishly to God, God is not going to give him anything. He should ask for all Muslims. Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. Guide us all to the right. So before going for the prayer, a person should say seven times, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan rajeem, wa a'udhu billahi min shurur nafsi wa min sayyat amal. And all the jealousy and all the hatred and all the enmity and all the selfishness and all the intrigue of undercutting so and so in the market and of robbing so and so of this thing and of doing that thing and all those things, he should leave outside the masjid. Otherwise he has no right to come and stand there. All right. Then comes a very crucial point here. Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. Up to this time, the worshipper is concentrating only on God. But Islam is incomplete without the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Everywhere, at every point, incomplete. Starting from the kalima. At every point, Islam is incomplete without the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So, now he has to concentrate on two. On Allah and on his beloved Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. Sirat al-lazina anhamta alayhim. The path of those whom thou hast blessed. And who has been blessed more than the Holy Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. So, he has to concentrate right here. This is a very important point. All right. This is for the start. What about the end? The prayer has been performed. He is now to make the salam and finish it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you are not welcome. Stay outside. Outside. Not here. Take the help of my beloved Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam and then come here. Otherwise, don't come. The gate is closed.
Allah.
So, he sits down in the car. At-tahiyyatu lillahi wa salawatu wa tayyibat. Praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he turns to the Holy Prophet. As-salamu alayka ayyuhan nabiyyu wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Now the job is done. You send the salam on the Holy Prophet says from there, wa alayka as-salamu wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And when the Holy Prophet says wa alayka as-salam, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts. Here this thing has come now through proper channel. Through proper channel. With the blessings of the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam, not without that. And then in gratefulness, you say, after that, As-salamu alayna wa ala ibadillahi salihin, ashadu an la ilaha illallah, wa ashadu anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. You have to affirm there, that although Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given such an eminent position to the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam, that he is the only gateway for obtaining his blessings, but he is his abd and he is his messenger. He is not God. This is to be affirmed in order to maintain the balance of mind. So, you have been asked to say, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu. I bear witness that Muhammad alayhi salatu wa salam is the slave and messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is not God in any sense of the word. Then again in gratefulness to the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and to the whole list of prophets of Millat Ibrahim through whom the guidance came to us. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala Ali Muhammadin. كما صليت على ابراهيم وعلى ال ابراهيم انك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى ال محمد كما باركت على ابراهيم وعلى ال ابراهيم انك حميد مجيد and now you make the prayer for yourself اللهم اني ظلمت نفسي ظلما كثيرا ولا يغفر الذنوب الا انت فاغفر لي مغفرة من عندك وارحمني انك انت الغفور الرحيم now it will be accepted. As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah.